The fact that Christ is risen changes everything. A vision is planted within our heart till we begin to see we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. My prayers is that God will plant a vision within you as we move forward and discover there's hope, there's help. Christ is risen. Hope we have for the future. What a vision God desires to plant within our hearts at this particular moment. We are seeing God do a great and mighty work. As we celebrate 51 years of His faithfulness, He's planted a vision in the hearts of all of us here at the New Life Evangelistic Center, and how I thank God for our partners. And because of what the Lord has done through these faithful partners during the last 51 years, we are seeing so many lives changed. Many of you have heard that 1411 Locust Street, the previous headquarters of New Life Evangelistic Center, was shut down. But instead of that stopping the work of New Life, it has thrust us into new areas as we work to get back in that building as a living, vital church that's so essential in the downtown St. Louis area where there's now so much violence and bitterness, hostility, and danger. As they shut down the New Life Evangelistic Center in April 2017, we've seen all of this unfold since then. That's why we need to be that salt and that light in the midst of that darkness. Later, my grandson, Chris Aaron's going to be going in some detail, sharing with you the vision for that, and also how we're praying for a shelter, a 24-hour facility in St. Louis County. Yes, in St. Louis County is where we locate that at this time, where there's literally no work that you can get the homeless into, no shelter you can get them into when you find them out there. So we've been going out to them and ministering to them and taking emergency supplies to them, working with over 90 homeless people that are out there that can't get into shelter in St. Louis County, plus 250 to 300 in the city. So yes, New Life Evangelistic Center's on the front lines. Yes, God has given us a vision. And yes, we're moving toward that vision as a result of all of you that are praying, caring, and sharing. I praise God for those that gathered together recently at a Faith Promise dinner that New Life Evangelistic Center had at the Orlando's in Maryland Heights. Now another one is scheduled for July the 22nd at the Royal Orleans in South St. Louis County off of Telegraph Road. I'll tell you more about that later. But now I want to give you an opportunity to let the Holy Spirit do exceedingly abundantly beyond what you can ask or think. I'm asking you to pray for the work of New Life Evangelistic Center. I'm giving you an opportunity to see for yourself many of the things that we describe on these programs. Directly encounter the hurting and homeless. It can change your life like it has one of our volunteers who started going out with Pastor Ray Redling downtown St. Louis, saw Ray pull up to what looked like a trash pile, holler a man's name, and out a man came out of the trash pile and they ministered to him. Many are living, hurting, homeless. And as we rescued them, we're able to send them, the men out to New Bloomfield, Missouri, the women to the safe houses. So many things God is doing, but so much He's got planned for the future. And that's why I want to encourage you to continue to work with New Life Evangelistic Center. Continue to partner with us. For further information, call us at 314-421-3020 or go to www.nlecstl.org. For truly the Lord, our risen Lord, desires to do exceedingly abundantly beyond we can even ask or think. Let's go now to Chris Aaron.
Today, I have been tasked to cast the vision for where New Life is going. And Scripture says that without a vision, the people perish. And we know that it is important to seek the will of the Lord and how He might be moving New Life into new areas. And as my grandfather said, I've been working full-time with New Life for 4 years now and have been an integral part of seeing God move us in different directions. And I want to share with you some of the things that we see God doing right now. First, we have to understand the crises that our world faces. And I don't have to spend long to convince you that it is crazy out there in many different ways. There's not a lot of affordable housing, and this is one of the this makes it very difficult for people who are experiencing homelessness now, that there's not a place to move into that they can afford, even if they do have a job. Another
present crisis is the increasing levels of violence in St. Louis. Many of the women here tonight can share the harsh testimonies of violence done to them or violence that they've seen. But it's not just women, men too are preyed upon on the streets. It is a very violent and dangerous place to be. And truly, our hearts go out with each of those hundreds of people who do not know where they're going to lay their head tonight. They have to constantly keep their eyes on their things. They have to constantly be on guard against the police, against other people who might victimize them. It is very violent on the streets of St. Louis and all over our country right now. Another thing is that we're seeing an aging population of people who are experiencing homelessness, and this causes other significant barriers. It's very hard to employ yourself once when we have a culture that's geared towards younger or more talented. When it's hard for you to get a job, you don't receive disability or things like that, it's very difficult to break the cycle of homelessness if you find yourself in that situation. Disabilities are another thing. We're seeing people who are physically incapable in many ways to get a job or find a place that will be suitable for them to move around. And so there are some significant barriers, significant crises that we're seeing. And every single person has struggled with loneliness, with fear, despair, and hatred or anger towards the things that they can't control. You don't have to be experiencing homelessness to have these really strong emotions. COVID-19 has exposed just how lonely we feel, too, without intimate connections. And so this world is in need of hope. This world is in need of the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. That message has not grown dim, it's grown stronger over the years. And I don't know for sure, but I know that Jesus is coming soon. I don't know the day or the hour. The Bible says we won't, but Jesus is coming soon and we must prepare. And how do we prepare? We do the work that's set before us. And the Lord has set a lot of work before us. There's an increasing number of people who are experiencing homelessness. And the cause, the reason that they find themselves in this situation isn't going to change how we help them. How we help them is by loving them well, speaking the truth in love to them, walking with them in tangible, practical, real ways. And that's what New Life's been all about. Being the hands and feet of Christ. By giving food to those who are hungry. By presenting shelter for those who do not have a place to lay their head. By giving clothes that people need in due season. But we don't just give these things out. We also share conversation, deep, meaningful, loving relationships with them. We share the gospel with them. We share messages with them. And then we disciple them, we instruct them, we lead them, we correct them, we guide them to where God may have next for them. We find what are they gifted at? What do they love to do? What has God uniquely given them that can be applied to the community as a whole? And that's really, really important. You know, we're not left without one of the greatest tools, the Word of God. Amen. We have the Word of God as a tool to work in the lives of others. And if we read in Titus 3, verses 1 through 7, this is Paul instructing Titus on how to lead the church. He says, "Remind the church, remind them to be submissive to rulers and authorities, to be obedient, to be ready for every good work, to speak evil of no one, to avoid quarreling, to be gentle, and to show perfect courtesy toward all people. For we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures, passing our days in malice and envy, hated by others and hating one another. But when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that being justified by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life." Okay, here Paul does three things just here in three verses, or in seven verses, okay? First, he says, this is how Christians should behave. Submit to rulers and authorities. This one's great, okay? It says, show perfect courtesy toward all people. I struggle with that one today. I don't know about you. But he shows us the behavior. This is what it means as a believer to display your faith, right? He says, speak evil of no one, avoid quarreling, be gentle, and show perfect courtesy towards all others. So he sets the standard, and then he says, this is who we were before we knew Christ. We ourselves were disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures. So Paul himself recognizes that before God saved us, we were in a state of sin. We couldn't help but hate others and be hated by hating one another and be hated by others. That's the violence that we see around us in St. Louis today. But then Paul continues and he says, but when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us. Not according to your good works. We did not earn it. We didn't deserve it. But God washed us. He regenerated us with the power of the Holy Spirit. He made it possible for us. He justified us. He redeemed us. He made us able to do these good works. And he set the hope of eternal life in our hearts. He set the hope of God's inheritance for his children, eternal life and reunion with him. That's the hope that we have to share with these ladies. That's the hope that we have to share with people who are brokenhearted, in despair, lonely, angry, hopeless. The hope that we have is not wishful thinking, naive optimism based on any politician or policy that might be made. It's not based on our own strength. It's not based on anything else but God's work in our own hearts, and that's what we display to them. That's what we display to everyone. Okay? So that's the scene that we're in. That's the hope that we have to share. What is New Life practically going to do in the future to share this hope with people in need? Well, we're going to do that in a variety of different ways. One, we see the critical need of having a church in downtown St. Louis. We need the Word of God and the people of God and the Spirit of God in downtown St. Louis. And 1411 Locust is, it's our building. We've owned it. We've been there for 50 years. years or 40 years. And so we're still fighting that fight. I hope you have not lost track that we are fighting this fight with the city to open our doors again. But our emphasis is we need a church in downtown St. Louis. We need a church in word and deed. And so we want to be able to offer services to people who are experiencing homelessness and to the community as a whole, the hope of the gospel. So we want to be able to preach out of 1411 Locust. We want to be able to hold Bible studies. We want to be able to serve people with transportation assistance and other tangible needs like food and clothing and other things like that. But most and first and foremost, we want to share the hope of the gospel with people in downtown St. Louis. And we think that is vital. That is very important for us to do. And so we're still fighting for 1411 Locust. If that door were to close, we would continue to fight to be downtown. And we believe that the Lord would open a door for us to do that. And we want it to be at 1411 Locust. We're going to continue to fight until that's made very clear to us that it just can't be there. But as of right now, we are still fighting. We are in the process of an appeal. Our opponents have appealed the building permit that we have. And we just were, me and Ray and our lawyer, we just were able to testify to the important work that was being done out of 1411 Locust that happened this past week. So please continue to pray that we are able to be a church in downtown St. Louis. If this were not to pan out, we really want to take this federal because they're trying to close a church down. They're trying to prevent the church, and we have a First Amendment right to practice our faith in downtown St. Louis. This is an excellent building that we could serve hundreds of people from again, and whether it's Satan, whether it's just politicians who are getting paid, they're trying to prevent us from practicing our First Amendment right of freedom of religion. And so we're going to continue to fight tooth and nail as much as we can. So please pray for that. We also see the incredible needs for expanding our services in St. Louis County. Right now, there's a vacuum of services, particularly for men who are experiencing homelessness and families. There's nothing for families. People who are legally married, they do not have a place where they could go. And so we are seeking to partner with different agencies in St. Louis County, opening up a facility where we could have overnight shelter again, where we could offer shelter in meaningful ways to people who are experiencing homelessness in the county. And Joe is a big part of the work that we're doing right now in St. Louis County. He's finding more and more people there every day. And the county has turned a blind eye to them for the most part. They refuse to acknowledge that they exist. And in doing so, they're trying to push them to the city. Well, the city is overflooded. They don't have space. They don't have resources. And so many people are left in really, really rough places, okay? So we see New Life growing in St. Louis County, opening up another facility where we could offer a wraparound services to people experiencing homelessness. And then finally, globally, we are still ministering in India. We have orphans and widows and people in need in India. And we started to work in Ukraine, and we want to continue to offer services in Ukraine by sponsoring and helping churches there to minister to people who are experiencing the brokenness of this war in Ukraine. just a day, most of Ukraine was attacked. They had this European singing competition. It's not so big here in the United States, but it's called Eurovision. And while Ukraine is hosting this event in Great Britain, Russia took the opportunity to shoot many missiles at Ukraine. And so this war is not over. There are so many people who are losing houses and homes and businesses, and it's going to take many years for Ukraine to rebuild. And New Life wants to be right on the front line, helping them and spreading the gospel in word and deed throughout the world. That is our vision. And how is New Life going to be able to do this? Well, the early church faced many crises like the ones that we face today. And Paul gives us a glimpse of how God worked through the churches to minister to people who were persecuted for their faith. They were persecuted from famine, from drought. Jerusalem in particular went through a very severe famine during the time of the early church. And Peter and the church there in Jerusalem was suffering in a great way. And so what does Paul do? He spreads the need with churches who have never been to Jerusalem, never heard about that church. They had never met Peter and John and all of these other pillars, and yet they gave in amazing ways. So if we look at 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 1 through 4, this is what Paul says. He says, "We want you to know, brothers and sisters, about the grace of God that has been given among the churches of Macedonia. For in a severe test of affliction, their abundance of joy and their extreme poverty have overflowed in a wealth of generosity on their part. For they gave according to their means, as I can testify, and beyond their means, of their own accord, begging us earnestly for the favor of taking part in the relief of the saints." Here was a church that was really poor. Economically, they did not have a lot. The members of the church and the house church could not really help, but they begged Paul, "Please let us help. Let us help Peter. Let us help the church in Jerusalem." And their joy in their persecution and their joy to give ended up where they gave above and beyond their means. They didn't know where the money was going to come from, but God blessed them in a miraculous way to be able to use their gift to inspire many other churches to give. And so this is Paul writing to the Corinthians, a different church, and he's saying, look at what God has done here, right? And he clarifies his point in 2 Corinthians 9. He says, 2 Corinthians 9, 6 through 8. The point is this. I love it when Paul tells us what the point is, because sometimes it can be very confusing. But Paul says, this is the point, okay? Pay attention here. "Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each person must give as he has decided in his heart. Not reluctant, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. The point is this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work." Okay? The Lord bountifully supplies all our needs. We are ambassadors. We represent the high God who owns all of this. You and I just represent him. And we represent him with our resources. We represent him with our work. We represent him with our time. We represent him with our words. And when we represent him in a God-honoring way, he supplies what we need above and beyond what we ask for, so that he receives the glory. My God's, my grandfather shared the verse, and we know that for those who love God, he works all things according to the good for those who are called according to his purpose. The very next verse is, for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. You and I must work together to look more like Christ. And when we do that, when we are ambassadors for God and his glory, we move in a mighty way. This is directly based off of 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and chapter 9. Paul goes into great length to encourage the Corinthians. They made a promise a year before to share in the work. He's encouraging them now to fulfill that promise. But this is a promise made that above and beyond what they would expect. We're not asking you to know where this money is coming from. We want you to grow in your faith together. We want all of us to grow in our faith together as we pray these resources in, as we pray that the Lord would give us above and beyond what we would expect for the Lord's work, that in all things, all sufficiency, at all times, we would be ready to do this work. So that's how New Life is going to follow and obey where the Lord is leading us. We're going to expect the Lord to supply what we need every day. And we're going to be ambassadors. We're going to be trustworthy with what he gives us for the glory of God, for the people of God, for the good of those who are hurting and suffering. And in doing so, we look more like Christ, and the glory of God is spread above and beyond any one individual or one agency could possibly do.
It's Saturday, July the 22nd, 6:30 p.m. at the Royal Orleans. You can be a part. Yes, you can have direct contact at this faith clinic, where we'll actually give you literature on how to build your faith and then give you an opportunity to be a part of a faith promise to fulfill the vision that Chris Aaron has laid out before you. He's laid out a big part of that vision. There's even more to it that we can engage in and share with you as you're there with us face to face. So you need to call now, 314-421-3020, make reservations to the historical dinner, or you can go online at nlecstl.org. But truly, the Lord has planted a vision in our heart as we continue to move forward, believing the Lord to do exceedingly abundantly beyond we can even ask or think. There's many times that we had to just really go before God. We didn't know anywhere from how the next meal was going to be made, provided for, how the next bill paid for. But the Lord has continued to be faithful, yes, during these last 51 years. And as indicated earlier, when 1411 Locust was shut down, all it did was thrust us to the streets and into new dimensions as we expanded the work at 806 North Jefferson in Springfield, Missouri, working now upwards of 125 to 200 homeless people every day coming in that particular facility. Expanding our farm outreach in New Bloomfield, Missouri, where homeless people with all different kinds of problems coming and growing in Jesus. Homeless men are there, as well as the training program, the safe houses, and women receiving training at 2428 Woodson Road in Overland, Missouri. So many things. And you'll be able to interact with many of these people and be able to personally hear their testimonies as you call in and sign up now for the next Faith Promise Dinner. The Faith Clinic is what we call it. Also, I've got special material to help you grow in your faith. A packet will be passing out to you. All kinds of other things. Opportunities. So, again, go to the phones and call. Make your reservations now while you can. At 314-421-3020, telephone operator, you want to come to the next Faith Promise Dinner that's taking place July the 22nd. Maybe you want to bring a friend with you, a relative with you, someone to introduce them to this part of the dynamic work of the New Life Evangelistic Center, where there's no vision, the people perish, many people stumbling through life, just trying to exist, when they could have a vision where we could see the Lord do exceedingly beyond. We can even ask or think. You're feeling all this condemnation, hopelessness, want to build your faith. Read Romans chapter 8. Starts out with there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Starts out with the fact there's no condemnation. And the whole chapter concludes that there's no separation. No matter how high you go, no matter low you go, no matter far or wide you go, you can never get away from God's love. Now, realizing the power and presence of the living God and the love He has for you plants within you a vision. And as you learn how to grow in your faith and you make a faith promise, and then you pray for that on a daily basis, and you see the Lord provide, it's going to build your faith for other problems that you may be facing in life. So be sure you come out and be a part of what the Lord is doing. You received part of the vision during this program. There's much more we want to share with you. And again, you can make your reservations by calling 314-421-3020. You can go online at www.nlecstl.org. Continue to pray for the work of New Life Evangelistic Center. You want to make your faith promise right now, or you'd like to just share a very special gift, you can send it to New Life Evangelistic Center, P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, that's 63166. You can give online at nlecstl.org. But please continue to pray for the work of New Life Evangelistic Center, as we believe for Almighty God to do exceedingly abundantly beyond we can even ask or think, and we celebrate His 51 years of faithfulness. To God be the glory. What a mighty God we serve.